contract and give the main ideas of the proof of the Hickman embedding theorem. And then this some words about a spherical embeddings, when you embed a spherical group into finitely present a spherical. So the, remember what we did? The idea was that we construct two disks, right? So that there's a group where relations are, I mean, cells corresponding relations are the cells which are inside these disks, right? So remember that, what we need to remember is that these disks consist of, so the first one consists of 12 copies of something, something like that, connected by, right, so this is K1, this is K2, so K1 commutes with all the status, and K2 commutes with all the status, and so on, right, it's 12 of them, and this, pieces are just pieces corresponding to computations of some machine, okay, and we have this cell in the middle, which is called the hub. In fact, we have two hubs. It's hub number one. And in the second disk, we have 11 sectors, like this. 11. So there is also empty sector, which is what I mean. Instead of this sector, we have empty. There is nothing, no tape letters here are inserted. On. Other sectors are very similar to these ones. Okay, and remember that, what did we have? We have some group XR, right? We have a new group, which is given by generators, which appear here as labels, and relations, which appear here as cells, right? There are a finite number of them. And we have a homomorphism from here to this new group, G, right? Because a word, I mean, this word differs from this word by this word U. So if this is equal to 1 and this is equal to 1, then U is also equal to 1, right? And U is precisely the element of R. So that's, okay, so that's the thing. And so the important thing is to prove that this homomorphism is injective. Okay? Injective homomorphism, right? So it means that if you take any word in the alphabet X, right? And if it happens to be equal to 1 in G, then it should be equal to 1 in the original group gamma, right? So there is one trick that we need to use here, and it's also a very common trick. In fact, the whole my three talks, I brought a bunch of tricks. This is one of them. So the trick is we increase the presentation of G. That's one of the tricks. We increase the presentation of G. So of course, this is a finite presentation, which is drawn on the board. By the way, this is called the hub number 2. We have two hubs. Okay, there are finite. It's a finite presentation, but we add new relations to make it infinite presentation. Which relations we get? We know that every word from R is equal to 1 in G. Let's add all these relations. Add all relations, R equals 1. Okay? Now, we add these relations, and now we have this finite number of relations, this new relation which followed from the, but we added anywhere. Okay? Now, we grade relations. So some relations are better than others. That's another trick. The trick is that we consider relations, which is finite number of relations, are infinitely bigger in the hierarchy than relations which we just added. So if you have some diagram, okay, and we just take some sub-diagram, for example, right, and replace this. And on the border of this subdiagram, on the boundary of the subdiagram, you have a word from R, right?
We just replace the subdiagram by this one cell. R, I mean decrease the diagram. Okay? So if, you understand? So we just decrease the diagram. So that's a possibility. So one way to grade this is to make these new cells to be infinitely smaller. Okay, so another, in the gradient. So we just grade the cells. We say that some cells are better than others. In another approach, they're infinitely bigger. Okay, so we like them more than the other cells, right? Okay, that's another. Okay, so now, if we again, so we take now a word from in the alphabet X, that's our word W in the alphabet X, and suppose that it is equal to 1 in G. Okay. Take the minimal possible diagram for this word, so we have a Duncan diagram. So what do we want to show? We want to show that this diagram has no cells except the cells from which we just added. So if this diagram was equal to 1 in the new group G, right, we want to show that it is equal to 1 in gamma, which means that there exists a diagram over the presentation of gamma. Right? So this is a diagram also over the presentation of G because we added the cells from gamma. Right? It's also the diagram over presentation of G, and we want to show that there are no other diagrams. I mean, if you take the minimal diagram, that's it. That's what, okay, that's the idea. Okay? So that's kind of idea, which is, again, it's a trick which is used all the time. Not just in this bit, but everywhere. Okay? So just, it's one of the tricks. Okay? So how to do it? It's the following thing. Suppose that the diagram is not, contains some other relations. Okay, suppose it contains some other relations. Okay, good. So if it has some relation, like with the theta in it, so other relations are either halves, or contains theta in it, right? Okay, or maybe k, they're also k relations. Okay, so if there is theta, so what can happen? Yeah, suppose that there are no halves. If there is no half, this is just an HN extension of essentially HN extension of some free groups, right? So if it has some theta, right? So we know what happens. This theta forms theta bands, and that there are no theta circles, no circles. So it means that it must have status on the boundary, but it's impossible because X doesn't contain theta. Okay, so very easy. Okay, so there must be halves. Good. If there are halves, these halves form a graph of degree 12, right? Halves form a graph. There are two kinds of halves, the black and white, first and second. Okay, so that form a graph. So then, what can happen? There may be two halves, number one, connected by... Yeah, if there are no multiple edges in this graph, right? We know we have a graph, planar graph of degree 12, there must be some vertex of degree 3 by this theorem published in 1861, right? And so there must be some hub which has edges coming to the boundary, right? What are edges? Edges are these bands corresponding to letter k. And then there will be letter k on the boundary, but on the boundary there are no letters k, right? So there must be two hubs connected by two edges. Must be two, right? So what happens? So if you have these two hubs, suppose there's just one and one. And we know what it is. So if you look at this, between these two consecutive edges, so this is say K1, this is K2, what is this thing? This is exactly, and we know, so here we have a word corresponding to empty thing, it's what is it? Alpha Q0 omega. This is also alpha Q0 omega, and this is a bunch of thetas. So what is this? This is a computation. It's a computation of our machine, which is just starts with empty word and ends with empty word. Okay, so we can assume there are no such computations. It's very easy to assume. So that it's like if you have end word, the stop word of the machine, we cannot start with stop word and produce another stop word by using reduced computation. Okay, so that's possible to assume.
So if it is 1 and 1, then this is empty. This is empty, and then these two halves are just, they share this part of the boundary, and there are mirror images, such as the diagram is not reduced. We cancel. Okay? Right? So this is impossible. 1 and 1 impossible. Now, 1 and 2. What will happen if it is 1 and 2? Also, 2 and 2 is impossible for the same reason. 1 and 2. What will happen if it is 1 and 2? Now, this is possible. And in fact, that you actually noticed it last time. This is possible because what is the standard diagram in G for R equals 1? It is just this disk. And it is better to consider for example, take a sphere. Take an equator on the sphere. Put this diagram on the northern hemisphere. Put this diagram on the southern hemisphere so that this thing identifies with that thing. So what we have is a sphere with a hole. The hole is labeled by this thing. Exactly, right? This is one compound diagram where the boundary is labeled by U. But what's inside the diagram? We have these two halves connected, so each edge, K band, starting on this half, ends on this half. It starts with the north pole, goes and goes down to the south pole. Right? So that's what right? So, okay, but the thing is that is exactly what will happen. Okay? So, again, so what we have here is the first half, the second half. So we have somehow we have some machine number one from the first disk working, and then it switched to machine number two. Right? So look where the switch appeared here. So there may be several switches, but just for simplicity, assume that there is one. So machine number one and then machine number two working like this. Right? It's exactly what happens when we glue this to this together. So this sector turns out into this sector when we glue them together, right? So this diagram is a part of what? Is a part of the diagram which I just described on the sphere. So what we do is we just cut it off from here and replace by the complement diagram from the sphere. The complement consists of this cell R equals 1, which is right, plus a bunch of other cells. Okay? But what is important is that the complement contains fewer halves. You understand? So we just remove two halves and replace it by the rest plus to this cell. You understand, right? So we kind of decrease the number of halves. What does it mean? It means that we want to say that halves are even more important than everything else. If we decrease the number of halves, we minimize the diagram. Okay? So in other words, okay, so we have the gradient is kind of finite that I just told you. So there are halves, which are very important. There are other cells from the presentation of G which are also important. And there are this is the lowest in the food chain. This is the cells that we added. Okay. So what we just took, what was the surgery? We just took this thing out, removed two halves. We had lots of other cells like this, but they are all smaller. Right. And we added one more, just completely insignificant cell.
Why do you not just add a single? You gotta add the rest of the wheel.
Yeah, you have to add the rest of the two wheels.
Rest of the both wheels.
Both wheels.
Right.
So look at this. This is on the sphere. We have the hub, the southern hub, the northern hub. They're connected by this thing, right? And the complement of the sphere has the same boundary. So we just cut it off and then replace by the complement. The complement has fewer halves. Okay, so you see? This way, we reduce the number of halves. And when there are no halves, I know what to do, right? So no halves, we already know. That's it. So after we do this, all the operations, what will happen is that we have lots of cells, right? But all the extra cells cancel. And we produce a diagram which consists only of the lowest cells. Right? That's an argument. Okay, so that's a nice
kind of idea, and it uses, it is used all the time. All the time. So that's one standard tricks.
So sometimes, so we grade relations. So relations are better, some relations are better than others. That's the first trick. Sometimes we also grade the generators. So some generators are better than others. So for example, so we consider query graph. In the query graph, every edge has length one. But it's not what you want usually. So usually we have, for example, tape letters are much smaller size as theta's. Usually, in all our papers with a chance kit. And so that's what happens. So we just,
we also grade the generators. Okay, so that's a grading idea. Now, another thing, I told you, in fact, already about two major ideas which I used here are this blends, right? Let's just try to explain what. The blends, the strips, the what's called corridors, right? So it's the first idea, and the second idea is small constellation, right? So the small constellation, if you have a presentation with small constellation, and then every diagram has a bump, right? Okay. Now, using small constellation, you can prove lots of results, right? So that's.
Let me prove one embedding result using small constellation. It's the only result due to Hinman-Norman Neumann.
Namely, every group embeds into two generated groups. Okay? So everybody knows that.
Every countable group embeds into two generated groups. Right? So what's the proof?
The proof is very easy.
So we have a group G, which is countable. Right, so X is countable set, and we have a generic presentation, for example, just the multiplication table if you wish. Okay, and we want to embed it into, two generated groups. So it's two generated using some relations R prime. Okay? I mean, the proof of Hinman-Norman uses HNN extensions, and it's kind of very complicated. I mean, construction is kind of complicated. There is a trivial construction using small constellation, and the construction is this. You want homomorphism, just do it. What's a homomorphism? You want to, for every generator X, you assign a word W sub X from F2. Okay? Assign it. And then what do we do? After that, so we want it to be a homomorphism, so every relation R, right, for every R, from R, phi of R must be equal to 1 in this group, right? So it must belong to R1. Okay? So the statement is, okay, so if we just say that R prime to be just phi of R, okay? Let's have R prime to be phi of R. So we just take relations from G and map it here. Just replace every letter by W, every letter X by WX, right? And we have this. It's a homomorphism. Right? So we have a homomorphism from this group into this group. It's for every phi. In fact, phi is the homomorphism. We want it to be injective. And it is injective if the set WX satisfies small constellation. So if WX, the set of WXs, X from X, satisfy this magic number C prime 112, or maybe 1/10 is still okay, then this is injective homomorphism. Okay? So what's the proof? Let me just give you the proof. The proof is this, very easy. So what do you want to show? You want to show that if you have some word U from F X, so it's generated by X, so U is a word in X, right? You want to show that if phi of U is equal to 1 in the image, And then u is equal to 1 in the group, right? Good. So what does it mean? It means that if you have phi of u, what is phi of u? So we take word u and we place every word, every letter by every letter x by wx, right? So phi of u is a product of wx's. X1, x2, and blah, blah, blah. Okay? Okay. So if this word is equal to 1, so it means that if there exists a diagram where every cell is the image of the relation R from R, then we should prove that U is also equal to 1. So there exists a one-compound diagram over the representation of G, so every cell is just R. Okay? Right? So if this diagram exists, then this diagram must exist. So if phi of u is equal to 1, then u is equal to 1. Right? That's what you want to show. Okay? So now, we actually have the opposite thing. If we have a diagram for u, and we replace every edge of this diagram, every edge by a path labeled by wx, right? So we take this diagram, and we take every edge and replace it by wx. Right? So we replace every letter by w, by phi of this letter. We get a diagram with, so if, I mean, I told you before, so if u is equal to 1, then phi of u is equal to 1, then we change. Right? So the statement is, there are no other diagrams. Okay? So every diagram with boundary label of this form must be obtained from this diagram by replacing every letter by every letter x by path wx. Okay? Why? Here is the proof. Again, so it's trivial. Okay. First of all, remember I told you, so with diagrams you can do one thing, you can remove diagonals. Right? So that's, we used it many times already. If you have two cells sharing an edge, and the cells are mirror images of each other, we just remove. Right? There's another move for every diagram, it's called diamond move. It is the following thing. Suppose that inside the diagram, this is a diagram, we have two edges, this is A and labeled by A, coming from the same point. Okay? So what do? We cut it along this path, right? So what you get is kind of this thing. This is a hole, no? And then we identify this A with this A, and this A with this A. Okay? We get also one compound diagram, and we collapse this hole, but in a different way. So how do we use it? For example, if you have this diagram and you have two passes labeled by the same thing, by the same word, u and u, we can identify this pass with this pass. That's what it is. We have two A's, right? We cut along this, so we have this hole like this. We have four edges, A labeled by A, and then we have this with this and this with this. So these two edges now are identified. The new diagram. We say that it's again equivalent move. Right? It's equivalent move. Okay? In particular, suppose that we have a diagram with this kind of label of the boundary, and suppose that inside we have two cells, so all cells are of the form phi of r equals 1. So phi of r means that every cell has also the form wx, wy, and blah, blah, blah. And suppose that we have, usually these things are called blocks. Suppose that we have two cells and they share portion of a block. The big enough portion. You know, we have small conservation condition. So if you have two blocks, wx and wy, which share like more than 1/12 of themselves, right? They are the same, it's x and y was. So if, so this is a block, say wx, and this is a block wy, and they share a lot, say more than 1/12, then actually x and y are the same, because of small conservation. And then we can use a diamond move to actually identify this path with this path. And this path with this path. So if we have two cells which actually share a lot, then we can use a diamond move, we can say that they actually share a block. Okay? So what is the diagram obtained from this diagram by replacing every x by wx? It's a diagram satisfying the following condition. So every two cells are attached by complete blocks. Right? So here they are attached by edges. When we replace edges by blocks, right, by wx's, then they are now attached by w. That's precisely the definition of a diagram of this form, when we obtain, we take the original diagram replaced by every x by wx, okay? So we want to show that every diagram with this boundary label is what is called normal. Normal, it means that if every two cells and then the blocks are attached by complete blocks. They don't attach by small blocks, okay? That's what we want to show. That every diagram looks like this. Because if it is so, we can just get back. Replace every cell by the image and we get a new example. Okay, so suppose that it's not the case. Take the maximal normal subdiagram. There is one normal subdiagram. For example, every cell is normal, right? Take a maximal such a cell. It's a completely standard argument, which is used 1,000 times in many papers. Okay, so I just want to demonstrate it. Okay, take the maximal normal subdiagram. Normal means that every two cells are attached in a normal way, by complete blocks. Okay? Now, so we have this diagram. Right, this W axis, and we have some maximum normal subdiagrams. There is a slight complication. The maximum normal subdiagrams may not be simply connected. Maybe some holes in it. But the hole in such a thing, since it is a normal diagram, the hole also has a label like this. Right? Okay? And the hole is smaller. So by induction, we assume that the holes are already good. So the holes are normal, so it means that there are no holes. We patch the holes with normal diagrams. Okay? We want to show that every diagram is normal. That's just it. Okay? Do it by induction. Right? So no holes. Okay? So now, we have our diagram with this nice boundary. We have this normal subdiagrams. Maximum normal subdiagrams, how do they interact? What's the connection? We know that this boundary of a normal subdiagram is a product of blocks. This is a product of blocks. If two normal diagrams share a big portion of a block, then the union is again normal. Right? Use diamond moves and then union. Union is again normal. Okay, so it's impossible, right? We take maximum normal subdiagrams, right? Okay? Impossible. So every two diagrams, normal diagrams, share small portion of a block only. Only small portion of a block. But then it means that if you look at this thing, at this picture, as a kind of diagram, like meta diagram, where cells are normal diagrams, they form small constellation. Right? So the any two cells, any two of these meta cells, are share only less than 1/12. Of the boundary, right? So this forms small constellation, right? And you know what happens when we take small constellation picture? There must be a bump. So there is a normal diagram kind of sticking out by a lot, right? So in particular, there is a whole block which shared by normal diagram and the boundary, right? The whole block is there. But then we just cut off the normal subdiagram. Without it, it's still a diagram of the same kind. Since it was a normal diagram, the boundary of the normal diagram is a product of blocks. We just remove this product of blocks and replace it by this product of blocks. Remove. So we have fewer normal subdiagrams, and the diagram is still the same. So it means that the whole thing is normal. It's induction. Absolutely. If you think about it for just a few moments, you will see that it's completely trivial kind of a result. So what the entire Sapir group is embedded into a two-generated group. Okay, so that's what it is.
You could take the image to be a question. I mean, you could take F in place of F2 many times.
Yes, that's another thing. This was proved by Shansky. In fact, this argument is due to Shansky. And he proved it for any hyperbolic group. So it's not F2, just any hyperbolic group. Let's use H for hyperbolic group. Right? But then the small consolation is not quite enough. You have to have some, I mean, you can, not arbitrary small consolation will work, but there exists certainly a bunch of words, the infinite number of words, Wx, in every hyperbolic group, which do the trick. Okay? This is called the congruence extension property. So what's a congruence extension property? This is a very important property for model theories, introduced, I think, by McIntyre. What it is that if you have a hyperbolic group, it always contains a free subgroup, infinitely generated free subgroup, that's called F, such that if you take any normal subgroup of F, for every normal subgroup of F, that's what this normal subgroup. So in our case, for figure, this subgroup is generated by this W axis. Okay, so that's our free subgroup of free group. Okay, so in general, for arbitrary hyperbolic group, there exists some free subgroup F. So that for every normal subgroup of F, right, for every normal subgroup of F, if we Q N, so if we take H and Q N, so take a normal subgroup of generated by N in the whole group and Q it, then F over N embeds into here. Okay, so again, so we take H, that's our hyperbolic group, we take this N, N is not normal in H, N is normal only in F, right? We take the Qn in the whole H, Qn in H, right? We have some group, of course F over N maps into here, it's an exponential map from here to here. Right, because again, here we give n, we kill n, here we kill something more than n. Right? This map is injected. Or in other words, if you take this normal subgroup generated by n intersecting with f is equal to n. That's what's the same. Okay, so it's called congruence extension property, and every hyperbolic group contains subgroup is congruence extension property. Free subgroup is congruence extension property. In particular, every countable group embeds into the quotient of every non-elementary hyperbolic. Right, so in other words, hyperbolic group is SQ universal, which exactly this means this every countable group embeds into a factor group of every of hyperbolic group.
Okay. This Ushensky's contribution to that? Mm-hmm. It seems like
it's a Ushensky problem.
I see. But this is like kind of obvious result of CEP.
Of what?
Obvious consequence of.
Yeah, but CEP is what Shansky proved.
I see.
Of course, yes. Shansky proved CEP of hyperbolic groups. And it is not. So the argument is very similar to this, but here you also have you have to have cells corresponding to this presentation of H. So H is not free anymore. Okay, so it really doesn't matter too much, but that's what happens, okay? Okay, so that's it. Now, what I also want to explain is this asphericity embedding. So I explained how to embed finitely presented group into recursive represented group into finitely presented group. And now I want to explain, or at least to give some ideas of how to embed a spherical group. A spherical recursive represented groups into finitely presented spherical groups. It's much more complicated. I think it turns out spent about 10 years doing it, but let me give you some ideas. So the first thing is, okay, so let's look at this construction, at the construction that we already used. So this construction contains several components. For example, it contains this subgroup, not subgroup, but this, yeah, it's actually subgroup, the group given by this presentation. So what is this group? This is the machine, the simulation of the machine, right? So we know that this HLM extension of a free group. So the following observation is very important in this theory of the spherical group. I told you one example of a sphericity is one example of a sphericity is the group with small constellation, right? Remember that the diagram on a sphere cannot be, I mean, diagram over a small constellation presentation cannot be placed on a sphere because a sphere has no boundary and every diagram must have a bump, right? There are no boundaries, there cannot be bumps. Okay, so the small constellation groups are spherical. Another thing, but just from here, from this proof, suppose that this group is a spherical. Right? So it's infinite presentation, but it's quite a spherical, right? Then this group is also a spherical. Indeed. Suppose that this is just empty. Right? So it's, in particular, it's possible that this is a sphere, so it means that the boundary is empty. Okay? That means that the normal subdiagram must be also empty. You see, we also prove that there is a bump, right? That's exactly what we proved. There must be a bump. Right? You understand? So if, right? Or maybe this diagram is actually obtained from a diagram in over G, right? By replacing every X by W. But that is impossible because our original presentation is spherical. Okay, so that's another idea. Okay, so the original presentation is spherical. We prove that every diagram over a new presentation is obtained from original presentation. So every diagram over a new presentation on a sphere must be image of a sphere of the old presentation. Right? And that's impossible because it was a sphere. Okay, so that's the thing. So the embedding, which I described, in fact, is a part of this theorem, is a spherical. So it means that if you start with a spherical presentation, you get a new presentation which is again a spherical. It's again, it's infinite presentation, but it's still, it's a spherical. Okay? And the third observation is also well known, and in fact, we also kind of proved it. If you have a group, G, and it has two subgroups, A and B, which are isomorphic, and suppose that both are free, and we take an HLM extension. HLM extension. Okay? So if G is a spherical, then HLM extension with free associated subgroups is also a spherical. Why? Okay, take a diagram on a sphere over this new presentation. If it contains, if it doesn't contain cells like TA, T inverse equals B, if it doesn't contain such cells, then it's a diagram over G, spherical diagram over G, and we assume that G is a sphere. If it contains such a thing, then there must be a band, T band, and this band goes, I mean, it's a sphere, right? So there is no bump. So it must be an annulus. Take the innermost annulus. So what's inside? Inside is a diagram with a boundary label B, but B is free. So this diagram is empty. Right? The diagram is empty, which means that, I mean, this word is equal to 1 in the free group. But that means that two cells cancel. Okay, so
So the HLM extension with three associated subgroups is always a spherical, is the original group of the spherical. That's the three ingredients which are used all the time in the proof of this thing. So now I will explain why this ingredient, this ingredient I explained last time, is not good for a spherical presentation. Okay? And this is very easy argument why it is not good. And then you will see, I will explain how to avoid this difficulty. And remember, okay, so we have, let's go back to this two disks. This is the first disk, it's the second disk. Look at the first disk. And look at the first sector here. This is where the problem is. Okay? So, what do we have here? We have here alpha, u, q1, omega. And what is the first layer? The first layer is theta, right? And theta, remember the relations involving theta? Theta commutes with alpha, right? Theta commutes with alpha. Theta commutes with every letter from u. Right. And theta does something with q, right? So it replaces q by a q and b, right? Okay. But this is the worst thing. So why is it the worst? It's because, okay, so, sorry, this is the worst. So this is x. This is a letter from u. Remember, some u's are equal to 1 in the big group, right? So that means in this group where we embed, in this finitely presented, this element from r, they're equal to 1. So there is this compound diagram, okay, where the boundary is r. It's a diagram over this g. I explained why g is not a sphere. This is. Okay, so now put it in another one of this, copy of it below. Okay, so this is vertical axis. This is vertical axis, it's just the same word r. And now connect them by theta. Theta commutes with every x. So we have a word, we have a compound, this compound diagram on top, this compound diagram on the bottom, and we have r, we have thetas going like that. But we get a sphere. We have, again, a disk here, and the other band, and theta band. It's a sphere. It's an impossible to avoid. I mean, this is an infinite number of spheres. You cannot even hope to add finite number of them and to generate all possible spheres. So, I mean, this is the string by one. Sorry, this is not a K by one. The presentation on G cannot be K by one. So what's the point? The point is this innocent looking relations. The theta commutes with x. And, okay? And this is a common feature of all, I told you, the 10 different proofs of Hilbert embedding theorem. In all these embeddings, there is this problem. So the original group has non-trivial centralizer. So there always exists some letter which commutes with every generator of the original group. Okay? And so that's the problem. Okay? And okay, so let me explain how to avoid it. How to overcome. Okay, and that's it, probably do it. Okay, so now I will draw a picture, which is, this is a picture. So the original disk was round, now I will put some bumps, the pikes. So there are 12 again, 12 of them. So first of all, the first change. The first change is, okay, so here, like all these sectors, are copies of each other. So it's more convenient
to put the alternating. So you take the center and then flip it. Center, flip it, right? So that's kind of more convenient. Okay, you just flip it, it's the same, it has the same boundary. And remember that this word is the same as this word, right? If you flip it, so that, that's convenient. And also, this letters K, remember K? So we have K1, K2, let's alternate them. So it's K1, T1, K2, T2, and so good. So now I will explain what these bumps are. So we have this word U, right? We conjugate it by something. Well, for example, let's call it Q, but alpha. Actually, we have this alpha. We conjugate it by alpha. We have here, so we put that every letter from U, which is this X, the original generation set, is conjugated to something. It's okay. So we have this X to the power of alpha, and we have to put something here. It's something small constellation. That's why the small constellation plays a role. So it's called UX, VX. Where UX, okay, so we are using now two alphabets. Okay, so we had one alphabet X, we now have two more alphabets. UX is in one alphabet, let's call it A. And this alphabet, new alphabet, let's call it C. Okay, let's call this is the white rice, this is black rice, okay? Yes, so we have white, black, white, black, white, black, black. So what we do is, we use some relations to separate white from black. So here we have white, here we have black. So the easiest way to do it is to assume that all white commute with all blacks. Right, so it's like direct product of two free groups, doesn't work. I mean, so what's the point? The point is that these letters are no longer commuting with anything. They are conjugated by alpha to something, and now this will be the sector. So there will be something commuting with white, but not with black. And there will be something commuting with black, but not with white. So blacks are free, whites are free. This is not free. Okay? The product of blacks and whites are not free, okay? So we separate blacks from whites, black rice from white rice, or whatever these two kinds of rice are, right? So, and this is where we use the Turing machine, and here we use just the conjugation, okay? You understand? Okay, so it's impossible to have that, as I said, if we just assume that black commutes with white, right? We do this, so we separate black and white, it's good. But, and we avoid the problem that there is something commuting with the axis, the original axis, right? Which is a good black problem, right? We avoid that, but we kind of push it deeper. The problem is deeper, so there exists still some non-free subgroup with non-trivial centralizing, and that's very good. It's not the original subgroup, gamma, but some others, non-free subgroup. So what happens is, here is a kind of mysterious group, which I mean, took me a long time to produce. It's a hyperbolic group, in fact, given by some small conservation condition, and it allows us to separate black and white. This word is very, very long. It's double exponential of this length. This word is also very long, it's also double exponential of this length, but still there is some kind of diagram, mysterious diagram over small constellation, which happens here. Okay? So that's what it is. This is our diagram. So this is our original word U. It conjugates to something, and then we separate black from white. This is white, this is black. Okay? And this is mirror image of this triangle, mirror image, you put it here, so the whites, and so the blacks cancel. Right? This is K1, this is T1. No. Okay? And this is just a mirror image. Okay? So this is a disk which we obtain. So now, what will happen here? You see, this word is not the original word, but it is obtained from the original word by some of the recent procedure. Right?
just some algorithmic precision. So there exists a Turing machine which recognizes such words. And there is also X machine which does it the same, also does it. So that's what we put here. Okay?
You understand?
Okay, and this is a mirror image, and so on. Okay? That's the first disk. The second disk doesn't change. The second disk doesn't change because in the second disk we have this this bad sector. You see the, this sector which contains the real data for the original group, the axis is missing here. Right? That's the whole point of it. So that's it. So that the idea is to avoid the necessity that there is some data, something which can be used with every generator of the original group. And this is what we do. Okay, so we take our word, original word, we separate it into two parts. There is something which can be used here and something which can be used here, but there is nothing which can be used to both.
So the only relators have to command both line, but they'll have to command like this. If you had an arrow which happened to be all white,
there are no such thing.
Yeah, that's what I mean.
Yeah. So there's here everything contains both black and white, right. And here everything contains, like for example, white and silver. Yeah. Right. So whites are free. That's important. So whites generate free subgroup. Blacks generate free subgroup. Right? They intersect. They non-trivially intersect. That's because this word is sometimes equal to one. They non-trivially intersect, but they're both free. That's important. Okay? Since it is free, you see, at least this thing, this group, with setters and this, is a spherical. That's an ancient extension of it. This is a spherical. This is a spherical because of the this thing. Because what is happening here is exactly, right? So we see that some words like this are equal to one in the Giga group, right? So then these words are equal to one. So in fact, this is a hyperbolic group. This is given by small translation plus relations which come from the original presentation, where we replace every letter by a small constellation of words, right? And this is also a spherical. This is a spherical. This is a spherical. And then the whole point is to prove that a combination is a spherical. And of course we are using all the time the fact that these hubs have degree 12, right? So the hubs, again, since it's kind of again small conservation idea, the hubs form this hyperbolic graph, the graph of degree 12. Right. So that's the idea behind this small conservation. But then after just finish with is the problem, since I was talking about the small conservation and the sphericity, so how to get back spherical groups? Remember that I told you that it implies that there is a finitely presented spherical group which contains expanded. So what's the point? The point is that there is an infinitely presented spherical group which contains an expanded. And that's the result of Gromov. And let me explain to you what it is. So since Zermatt explained what expander is, so let me explain how to embed it into a group. So what's expander? Expander is a sequence of graphs where the second eigenvalue, right, the second eigenvalue is bounded distance away from the large eigenvalue. The large, this is a k-regular graph, so the largest eigenvalue is k. The second largest eigenvalue should be bounded distance away from the largest one, right? The spectral graph is bounded. Okay, so that's... And there are lots of sequences of expanding graphs. Lots of them. They will produce several, like Margulis expanders and so on. These are bad. You cannot use them. Right? Why? Because of they have the following bad property. The graphs... So look at these graphs. Look at the length of the smallest loop in this graph. If you take a Margulis expander, there is always a loop of length 3. That's very bad. So you want a sequence of expanding graphs where the girth, the length of the smallest loop, actually grows. And
it's very clear what happens, why it's needed. So the girls, the road. You cannot construct such groups, such graphs, for example, by random procedure. So you just random graphs from expander, that's what Erdős proved. But they also satisfy this the small girls problem. But there exist what's called Ramanujan expanders, which don't satisfy this. So the Ramanujan expanders are good for us. Okay, so Ramanujan expanders, which I don't want to invoke, they are, but they are good. So all the others are bad. Okay, so now let's take the first graph, Gamma 1. And we want to embed it into some group. So we start with, let's say, so this is clear over. So start with FK. We want to factor R, some set of relations, so that Gamma 1 embeds into the Kelly graph of FK over R. Right? Okay, so what does it mean? I just say what it means. It means that if we label edges of gamma 1, right, so what does it mean by? We label edges of gamma 1 by generators of FK, right? And what does it mean by? If you have a cycle in gamma 1, should go to cycle in this group. Cycles in this group are relations from R. So, okay, so what is R? So we label gamma 1, produce labels of basic cycles. There are finite number, the fundamental root of the graph is free, finite rank. We take basic cycle generators of the fundamental root. So that means that the labels, the cycles, there must be cycles in here, so there must be relations in the new group. So that's what R is. How is this? Okay, it's kind of strange. It's very similar to this procedure in here. Label, right? And in both situations, it's impossible to avoid. Whatever clever thing you do this. Right? So why don't you just be honest with yourself and do it just from the beginning? So just don't try to be more clever than is needed here. Just do this, okay? So the point is that expanders satisfy the following property. So first of all, that the lengths of all these loops are approximately the same. They are approximately the log of the number of vertices, right? Approximately them, and the number of them, the approximate lengths are like within some constant multiple from each other. They are approximately the lengths of these elevators are approximately log the number of vertices, and the number of them is okay. So if it is something like theta times log the number of vertices, where theta is some small number. That's important. That's a property of expanders. What I was saying is that the total number of words of these lengths is, I don't know, 2k minus 1 to the power of n, where n is the log of the number of vertices, okay? And the number of loops, which are words of this kind of length, of this length, of lengths approximately n, is 2k minus 1 to the power of theta n, okay? Where theta, it's important, is less than 1 time. And what Gromov proves is that if you take a random labeling of this graph, random labeling, and for each of these labeling produce a new representation, then with probability greater than zero, this new group is hyperbolic, non-elementary hyperbolic. Okay? So what is proved this way is that any graph satisfying this kind of condition, right, embeds into the hyperbolic group, embeds into the hyperbolic group. Kelly graph of the hyperbolic group. Okay? So what's the proof? The proof is that random choice of relations, because of theta is less than 1/2, satisfies some kind of small cancellation condition. Not the small cancellation I explained, but some kind of small cancellation condition. I told you that every small conservation presentation, whatever you do, if it is small conservation, must be spherical because there is this bump thing. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's what the purpose of small conservation. Okay, so the next thing, you want to embed gamma 2 in where? In the factor group of this one. Okay, so it means that you take this group, it's called G1, and gamma 2 embeds into G1 over the new generating set. It's called this R1, R2. So the point is, if you can do it for free group, you can do it for hyperbolic group. Right? It's another kind of slogan, which is true. If you can do it for free group, you can do it for hyperbolic group, provided the set of relations are large enough. But for this, we need the Gauss to grow. Okay, so the next Gauss should be much, much more larger than the Gauss of gamma 1. That's possible to do. Okay, and that's what we do. So gamma 2 embeds into G1 over R2, which is called G2. Gamma 3 embeds into G2 over R3, and so on. Take a limit of this group, that's a Gromov group. It is given by a kind of small conservation presentation. Small conservation presentations are spherical. That's how we get a spherical group containing expanders. And then this theorem tells us that it is finitely presented a spherical group containing expand.
So the presentation is random, but you could measure it recursively.
Yes. Yes, so the point is, why is it recursive? It's because not only this is group is hyperbolic, but you know the delta. The delta is approximately 4 times the length of the relator, so all this prism, right? So, and if you know the delta, I think you explained it. Or did you explain it, please? Okay, but anyway, so if you have a hyperbolic, if you know that the group is hyperbolic is given delta, we can prove it. There is a certificate. Right? So we can prove, if you know the delta, we can prove it's hyperbolic. Right? So what we do, we know what delta expect. We take all possible labelings. For each of them, check if it is hyperbolic with given delta. Right? So that's what you, and similar to what you, right? And that's, this is an algorithm. It's very slow, like painfully slow algorithm, but it produces the recursive presentation. Okay, so thank you for that.